Hello friends, so let us continue our lecture on expressing or arriving at an expression for different components of stresses. So whatever we have been doing so far was leading up to a specific topic. We want to express the different components of stress that enable us to quantify the mechanical condition experienced by a specific region during different forms of testing. So we began by considering a two-dimensional setup. So this was our initial consideration. We began by considering a two-dimensional system wherein the region of our interest was inclined, and we quantified this region or the inclined region by dropping a perpendicular, and we quantified this to be theta. So this two-dimensional system was under a uniaxial tensile load, we denoted it as P, and the area perpendicular to this loading direction, that is AC, if we assume it to be A, and the area that is parallel to this loading direction, that is BC, if we assume it to be A prime, then the stress that was acting along or acting on AB, we expressed it using the area that was perpendicular to the loading direction and also using the area that was parallel to the loading direction. So ultimately the stress that was acting along AB, we expressed it in terms of sigma cos theta, where sigma was load, by area that was perpendicular to the loading direction. And similarly, we express the same the stress experienced by the inclined region of interest AB using the area that was parallel to the loading direction, and this we expressed it in terms of, in this manner, wherein this tau here is nothing but the load by A prime, which is area parallel to the loading direction. So for a given region of interest under tensile loading, we were able to express the stress experienced by it in two ways. One, involving the normal stress that is perpendicular or that actor along an area that was perpendicular to the loading direction, and using the shear stress that acted along in the area that was along the loading direction. So the stress that acted on a region of interest, we expressed it in two ways. One, using the normal stress, and other, using the shear stress. And we used appropriate angles, or we used these definite angles to relate to these different areas that we considered. So the region we began our understanding by considering an inclined area is because once you know or you are able to quantify the angle of inclination, then you can substitute the appropriate angle, and then you will end up with, or you can calculate the stress acting on that region of interest using the normal stress or the shear stress. So here what we have is the normal stress, and here what we have is the shear stress, and these change based on the areas that you select. So this we looked in a lecture that was few lectures before, and based on our understanding of the different ways you can express the stress acting on an inclined area, we extended it to three-dimensional case. So we assumed a three-dimensional rod and an area that was inclined to the loading direction, and for our convenience we made sure that the area of our interest was completely horizontal. We rotated the frames of reference in such a way that the area of our interest was completely horizontal and the loading direction correspondingly became inclined. And to quantify this inclination of the loading direction, we considered the normal to the area, and we quantified the inclination of the loading direction. So if you could remember, this is what the axis or the frames of reference we considered. Now under this condition, we saw that the normal stress acting on this particular, or normal stress acting perpendicular to the region of interest, was expressed as, if you assume this to be normal stress acting perpendicular to the region of interest. So since it is acting along the z direction, we denoted it in this manner, and this we expressed as sigma cos theta. So sigma is the overall tensile stress that is acting on the three-dimensional material, and this we projected it onto the direction that was desirous to us, that is the normal direction with respect to the area of interest, and then we were able to arrive at this expression. And when we wanted to arrive at similar expression for the shear components, we saw that when you consider the shear components, that is the area along the region of our interest, then it needed two components because there were two directions associated with this. If you can consider this frame of reference along the area of our interest, then you have two directions associated with it. Then we saw the expression for these two components of shear stresses involved, or rather, as something like this: sine theta, cos phi, the y direction, sigma sine theta, sine phi. So, all that we did was extended our understanding from the two-dimensional case, and we considered the stress acting on a region of interest in a three-dimensional system that is experiencing a uniaxial tensile loading. And we were able to see that under such a condition, the components of stress that was required to express the mechanical condition by an inclined region of interest in a three-dimensional system experiencing uniaxial tensile loading was 3, and this involved one normal component and two shear component. So this we extended to three-dimensional system, 3D systems experiencing triaxial loading. So when we extrapolate this understanding of a three-dimensional system experiencing uniaxial tensile loading to a triaxial tensile loading, we saw that 9 components was required to express the mechanical condition experienced by any plane in a three-dimensional system experiencing a triaxial tensile loading. Now, based on our understanding of the shear stress, and in order to maintain the rotational stability, we were able to reduce the 9 component to 6 independent components. The equality that enabled us to reduce the 9 components to the 6 components were this. Rather, so these equalities that one can understand from the rotational stability understanding of the stress square, and also from the moment of force, enabled us to reduce the 9 components to 6 independent components. So after understanding that we need 6 independent components for representing the mechanical condition experienced by a plane of interest in a 3-dimensional setup experiencing triaxial loading, we moved to consider a specific case called plane stress condition. So if you could recollect, we studied this plane stress condition using a plate, because this related, or this consideration or this assumption was analogous to plane stress condition. So under such a condition, we assumed a plate in this frame of reference, and the plate was oriented, let me use a different color, so this plate in red was oriented in this manner. So that means the area in the that area that is along the z plane was significantly higher than the area along the x plane and area along the y plane, and therefore when you consider the stress perpendicular to the z direction, which is nothing but load acting along that direction by the area z, then the load or the stress acting perpendicular to the z direction will be significantly lower than the load acting along the or perpendicular to the x direction, and the load acting perpendicular to the or along the y direction. So load acting in this case, the load is acting along the x direction and this load is acting along the y direction, so this should be perpendicular to the z plane, x plane and y plane. So when I say perpendicular, it is with respect to a plane, and it should be, when I say along the direction, it is along the z direction, x direction, or y direction. So if there is any verbal confusion, please rectify it. When I talk about stress acting with respect to plane, then it would be perpendicular to that plane. When I talk about stress acting with respect to a direction, it would be along the direction. So these stresses, so this one is acting along the z direction, while these two are acting along the x and y direction respectively. When you talk about plane, this is acting perpendicular to the z plane, these two are acting perpendicular to the x and y plane respectively. So once you are able to ensure that one of the components of the normal stress is very much smaller than the other two components, you ultimately end up having a plane stress condition. So under this plane stress condition, since this particular stress component is negligible, it means that these two, so these components also become negligible. So that means for a plane stress, under the plane stress condition, all that you need to express the components of stress is two normal stresses acting along the x and y direction and one shear stress. So we reduce from 9 to 6 using the conventions of the shear stress, and from 6 we reduced it to 3 for plane stress condition, just by considering a plane, or just by considering that one of the stress component is absent, or the stress acting in one direction is negligible. So we were able to reduce the number of components that was required to us in order to describe the mechanical condition experienced under a definite state. So that definite state is the plane stress condition. Now in the previous lecture, we worked entirely on the plane stress condition, or we considered the three-dimensional plate and we worked on it. We initially considered how under a uniaxial loading condition, the components of stress can be expressed for a three-dimensional plate. And we built on it, and in the previous lecture, the last part of the previous lecture, we were able to derive a set of expression that would help us understand the mechanical condition experienced by a plane in a three-dimensional plate that is experiencing biaxial loading. So when we talked about a 3D plate, we began by considering uniaxial tensile loading. With respect to this uniaxial tensile loading, we were able to calculate the normal components of stress and a shear stress, and these two were with respect to an inclined region of interest, and we expressed these two in terms of the overall stress that is acting on the three-dimensional plane. And now in the last part of the previous lecture, we based on this understanding, we consider biaxial tensile loading, and under this condition we calculated the similar normal stress that is acting with respect to a desired plane of interest, that is AB, and we expressed it in terms of the two normal stresses, or two mutually perpendicular load that is acting on the three-dimensional plane. And based on that, we were able to extract the two normal stress component, and based on the two normal stress components, or rather the two tensile stress components, and based on the two tensile stress components, we were able to calculate or express or derive an expression for describing the normal stress that is acting with respect to the plane AB. And similarly, we were also able to arrive at an expression for the shear stress acting along the plane AB for a biaxial tensile loading, and we expressed it similarly in similar terms as the normal stress using the stress which are mutually perpendicular and along the x and y direction. So if you could recollect, so the normal stress, or the stress acting perpendicular to our region of interest, we expressed using the mutually perpendicular stress that arrived from the load that are pertaining to the biaxial condition as sigma x cos square theta plus sigma y sin square theta. So in the previous lecture, I made a mistake while compiling the different forms of stresses, meaning when we derived it, we expressed it correctly in this form. However, when I was recollecting it, I just interchanged these two, sine square and cos square, which is absolutely incorrect. So I also posted the erratum for it. So whenever you are rewatching it, please be sure that when I was revisiting the expression that we have already derived, I just replaced the different sine and cos square thetas. So I'm please pardon me there. So whenever you are rewatching it, please be sure that the x is related to the cos square theta and the y is related to the sine square theta. So let me get rid of this. Now, similarly, in the previous lecture, at the last part of it, we arrived at an expression for the shear stress components that is acting along the region of interest AB, and this we expressed it as sigma x sine theta cos theta minus sigma y sine theta cos theta. So in this lecture, what we intend to do is, you know, arrive at a simplified expression for the normal stress component and the shear stress component. Now, the reason I have taken time, close to 15 minutes or so, to compile all that we have studied so far is, this would be the last time that we will be looking into the different expressions that quantify the different components of stress. So henceforth, what we will be doing is, we ultimately, or what we want to do is, we want to arrive at a simpler way of estimating the different components of stress. So in order to arrive at the simpler way, we want to have the fundamental understanding that involves all these derivations. And that is the reason why, since this would be the last time in this lecture series or in these modules, that we will be considering the explicit formulation for different components of stress, I have compiled it all together here. Now, let us try to simplify the conditions or the different expressions that we have for the normal stress and the shear stress. So for that, we will be taking help of our fundamental understanding of trigonometry. So let us try to make this different forms of stress more approachable. So all that we have been talking about, the expressions that we have above, these expressions, they pertain to a particular condition. So that is, we are talking about a 3D plane with unit thickness. And secondly, we are talking about a biaxial tensile loading. So that means you have mutually perpendicular load Px and Py, and from that we can estimate the stress sigma x and sigma y by relating it to the appropriate area. And now what we have done is, we have considered a region of interest. Under these conditions, we have considered a region of interest that is inclined by an angle theta. So under this condition, we have seen the normal stress that is acting under this condition perpendicular to the region of interest AB. Under this, all these conditions, only if these conditions are fulfilled, the normal stress that is acting perpendicular to our region of interest is expressed as sigma x cos square theta plus sigma y sine square theta. Now, if you could recollect your fundamental expressions of trigonometry, cos 2 theta can be expressed as 2 cos square theta minus 1. So cos 2 theta is nothing but 2 cos square theta minus 1. So you can bring this 1 here and have an expression for cos square theta, which should be 1 by 2, 1 plus cos 2 theta, rather 1 plus cos 2 theta. And similarly, there is also an expression for cos 2 theta that relates to sin theta, and that is 1 minus 2 sin square theta. So that means the sin square theta would be 1 minus cos 2 theta, 2 here divided by 2. So we have an expression for cos square theta. We also have an expression for sin square theta. So you can substitute these two expressions, you can substitute these two in this expression and express the normal component of stress as sigma AB, which is sigma x 1 plus cos 2 theta divided by 2 plus sigma y 1 minus cos 2 theta divided by 2. So here we have cos 2 theta and sigma x, sigma y 1 by 2, 1, 1 by 2. So the easier way of, you can rearrange it in an easier manner, and that way we have sigma x plus sigma y minus, rather, plus sigma x minus sigma y cos theta, cos 2 theta, and this whole of this is multiplied by 1 by 2. So if you can, if I can write it legibly, then it would be something like this: sigma x plus sigma y plus sigma x minus sigma y cos 2 theta. So all that we have done is we have substituted our understanding or fundamental expression for trigonometry and arrived at an expression for this. This is, by doing so, we have gotten rid of sine square theta and cos square theta, and all that we have end up with is this cos 2 theta, and theta is the angle of inclination or the degree by which the desired plane of interest is inclined. Now the other expression we have for the shear component of stress that is acting along the plane AB would be, we saw that it is sigma x sin theta cos theta minus sigma y sin theta cos theta. And now if you can take out this sin theta cos theta, this would be sigma x minus sigma y. So instead of having sin theta and cos theta together, we can consider the expression for sin 2 theta, which is nothing but 2 sin theta cos theta. So that means you have to have, you can express sigma AB, or rather tau AB, which is nothing but the shear component of stress acting along the region of interest AB, as sin 2 theta sigma x minus sigma y divided by 2. So you are bringing this 2 here and you are expressing it, you are replacing, so you are bringing this 2 here and replacing sin theta cos theta in this expression, and you will end up by this relation for sigma x sigma y involving sin 2 theta that ultimately gives you the shear components of stress. So you now have two simplified expression, one involving sin 2 theta, the other involving cos 2 theta. So if you could rewrite it, it would be something like this: 1 by 2, it comes out sigma x plus sigma y plus sigma x minus sigma y cos 2 theta. So your normal component of stress involves cos 2 theta, and the shear component of stress, as you can see here, is sigma x minus sigma y by 2 sin 2 theta. So these are a set of simplified expression to quantify the component of stress that is acting in the region of interest within a plate or a three-dimensional plate under biaxial loading condition. So you have an expression for the normal component of stress and the shear component of stress. Now based on this expression, we will try to define what is generally referred to as the principal plane. So we will try to introduce the concept of principal plane under this condition. So all that we have been doing, like we said, we have been simplifying the expression for the normal components of stress and the shear components of stress. This simplification will help us understand what a principal plane is. So we have several different planes. The reason that we have considered the angle of inclination or the inclined plane is because it will help us to treat any plane that is within the three-dimensional plate. So there are several different planes that are within the three-dimensional plate which can be characterized by the angle of inclination. Using the definite angle of inclination, you can talk about any plane of your interest within the three-dimensional plane. So we will now consider a specific plane called as principal plane within the three-dimensional plate. So the principal plane is described as the plane within the three-dimensional plate wherein the shear stress acting on that plane is zero. So the description of the principal plane is that the shear components of stress that is acting along that plane will be zero. So with respect to the biaxial loading condition, let us see how we can quantify or characterize this principal plane. So the definition of the principal plane is the shear stress acting along this direction or along this plane is zero, and we want to quantify what, or we want to find under which condition we will arrive at this principal plane, or how much inclination is required in order to arrive at this principal plane. So when we consider this condition, so this comes from the definition of the principal plane, that is, in this principal plane the stress acting along it is zero, meaning the shear stress acting along it is zero. So when we impose this condition on our expression for the shear stress, then you would have an expression something like this. Theta 0. So this expression here can only be 0 when this combination is 0, or when this term here is 0, or this term here is 0. So the only way these two is possible, or this complete description or the existence of plane, principal plane through the definition is possible, when this is 0 or this is 0. So we will consider this term to be 0 in the subsequent lecture, but let us begin with considering what happens when this term is 0. Because what we essentially want to do is, we want to characterize the principal plane within the three-dimensional plate. So one way of characterizing the plane of our interest is through appropriate angle of inclination. So the term that involves the angle of inclination is this term here. So this term here, it largely talks about the loading condition we impose. But what we want to arrive at is a definition or a description for the plane wherein the shear stress is zero. And the term that talks about the orientation of this plane is this term. And therefore, for describing the principal plane, we will be focusing on this term. So in this term, or the principal plane, based on this expression, would assume that sine 2 theta involving the inclination of the principal plane, that is the theta, is, it describes the inclination of the principal plane. So this is the term that involves the characteristic of the principal plane that we want to study, and therefore we have considered a condition based on this term. And now the ways one can fulfill this condition should be that the 2 theta either should be equal to 0 or it should be 180 degrees. The conditions under which, or the criterion under which this condition is satisfied, is when 2 theta is equal to 0 or 2 theta is equal to 180 degrees. So when you have a plane that is inclined by 0 degrees or inclined by 90 degrees, then there is no shear components acting on it. And when you have no shear component acting on it, then it we refer to it as the principal plane. So again, this is for a three-dimensional plate. When you have a three-dimensional plate experiencing a biaxial loading, and the angle of inclination of your region of interest, if it is 0 or 90 degrees, then the, or then under that condition, the plane that you are talking about is the principal plane. Because under such a condition, what we have is the shear stress acting along the plane is 0. It's completely 0, and that is what the definition of the principal plane is. So when you have a plane that is inclined to, or inclined by 0 degrees or 90 degrees in a three-dimensional plate experiencing biaxial loading, then that plane is a principal plane. So let us verify that. So we have arrived at this expression based on our description of the shear components. If you substitute 0 or 90 degrees, so our expression for the shear component experienced by a region or a plane of our interest is sigma x by sigma y by 2 sine 2 theta. So if you even go back to our previous expression of sigma x minus sigma y of sine theta cos theta, if you substitute 0 or 90 degrees in these theta, the sine term becomes zero, thereby ensuring that the shear component of the stress acting will be zero. So what we have done is we have arrived at, or we were able to identify definite planes along which the shear component of stress is zero, and we refer to that as the principal plane. So let us see under or in this principal plane what is the normal component of stress that is acting. So we define principal plane as a plane wherein the shear component of the stress is zero. Under this condition, when the shear stress is zero, what is the normal stress component that is acting along the or perpendicular to the plane? So along the plane there is no stress. What is the normal component of the stress? The other component of stress acting perpendicular to this plane is what we will want to quantify. So these planes are characterized by two angles, that is theta 90 degrees and theta 0 degrees. So the principal plane or the inclination of principal plane is 0 degrees and 90 degrees. So let us assume a case 1 where the theta is 0 degrees. So when theta is 0 degrees, it is a principal plane and the shear component of stress that is acting along the AB is 0. Now we want to quantify the normal component of stress for this case 1. The expression that we have for the normal component of stress is here, that is 1 by 2 sigma x plus sigma y plus sigma x minus sigma y cos 2 theta. So this is the expression we have for the normal component of stress that is acting perpendicular to our region of interest, and here the region of interest is a principal plane. Now when you substitute, theta is equal to 0 in cos 2 theta. So ultimately we will be talking about cos 2 theta, which is equal to cos 0 degrees, which will be equal to 1. So ultimately then the normal stress acting perpendicular to the principal plane that is inclined by 0 degrees would be 1 by 2, so cos 0 is 1, sigma x plus sigma y plus sigma x minus sigma y. So ultimately the sigma y terms get cancelled. So when your plate is acting, or when your plane is a principal plane that is inclined by 0 degrees, then the component of stress that is acting perpendicular to your plane of interest is completely the stress imposed by along this direction by the original loading condition. So let me repeat, when you have your region of interest to be the parallel or the principal plane that is inclined by 0 degrees, then the component of stress that is acting perpendicular to this plane is nothing but the component of overall stress that is acting along the x direction that is imposed by one of the biaxial strains. So it will be easy for you to graphically consider, it will be easy for you to understand the statement if you graphically consider the plane. So this is your plate and you have two loading direction, Py and Px, and with respect to the loading direction you have sigma y and sigma x. So with respect to the load and the loading direction you have sigma x and sigma y. Now instead of having a plane that is inclined, now we have a principal plane. Let me highlight that in different colors. So you have a principal plane and this plane is characterized by theta is equal to 0 degrees, and in that case when you have sigma y, a load along the y direction, a stress along the y direction, it means that it is acting along the principal plane. So that cannot be possible by definition, so this should be 0. So ultimately the only component of stress acting on the or acting perpendicular to the principal plane will be the component of stress that is sigma x that is acting along the x direction. So this is the case when theta is 0 degrees. Now we have another case, case 2 when theta is 90 degrees. So we saw based on our definition of the principal plane, when we substitute the definition of the principal plane, we saw that the principal plane is aligned or inclined along we characterize the inclination using two thetas, one is 0 degrees, the other is 90 degrees. And in case of 0 degrees, the only component of stress that is acting perpendicular to the plane is along the y-axis. Now we want to talk about the other condition wherein theta is 90 degrees. Now, as we have seen here, the role of the angular component is introduced in the calculation of the normal stress by cos 2 theta. The angular component of the theta plays the only role in cos 2 theta when you describe the normal stress component. So the normal stress component, the role played by the in the normal stress component by angle is cos 2 theta. Then in the case 2, this would be cos 180 degrees, 2 into 90 degrees, and this would be minus 1. And now when you substitute this value, the expression for case 2 that describes the normal stress experienced by a plane of interest, a principal plane that is inclined by 90 degrees, then it would be of this form, wherein 1 by 2 minus of, so this minus is introduced by the cos of 180, and ultimately under this condition you have your only normal stress acting perpendicular to the plane is equal to the stress that is introduced by the load that is acting along the y direction. So in case of the inclination or the principal plane characterized by the angle of inclination that is 0 degrees, the stress is entirely dependent on the load that is applied along the x direction. And in case of the principal plane that is characterized by the angle of inclination 90 degrees, the overall stress acting normal to your region of interest is caused by, or it is quantified by, the stress that is acting along the y direction, which is dependent on the load that is acting along the y direction. So if you consider the graphical representation, then this would be the plate, and we are just considering or assuming that the unit thickness is towards us. And when you consider the angle of inclination, that is 90 degrees. So with respect to the normal, then this would be the region of our interest, this 90 degrees. And we have two direction, loading direction, that is x and y. So this would be x and this would be y. And depending on this loading direction or the load, we have px or py and px, and correspondingly sigma y and sigma x. And now the only normal component or the only normal stress component that this principal plane or the region of our interest experience is the sigma y, because when there is any influence of sigma x, that means you have a load that is acting along the principal plane, then it spoils the overall definition of the principal plane. So that means the only stress that is, or the component of stress that is required to describe the mechanical condition experienced by a principal plane is the normal stress. So this normal stress, depending on the cases, might be sigma x or sigma y. For the angle of inclination that is 0 degree, we saw that it is the sigma x. For angle of inclination that is 90 degree, we saw that it is sigma y. So all that we have done is we have simplified the expression for the normal stress experienced by a region of interest in a three-dimensional place under biaxial loading, and also we have simplified the expression for shear stress that is acting along the region of interest within a three-dimensional plane experiencing a biaxial loading. So based on that, we quantified or we described definite set of planes as principal plane. So this principal plane, we defined it as those planes wherein there is no shear components of stress acting along it. So based on this condition, we were able to identify there are two planes that are inclined by an angle 0 and 90 degrees. And when we tried, or when you tried to substitute this angle of inclination in the expression for, or the expression that quantifies the normal components of stress, we were able to show that this normal component of stress is either equal to the overall stress that is acting along the x direction or the overall stress that is acting along the y direction. This is because when there is any other forms of stress that is acting on, and if there is any other forms of stress that is acting along the these planes under principal plane condition, it deteriorates the overall purpose or the description of the principal plane, and thereby the only possible stresses are sigma x and sigma y. So this is a special condition or the special types of planes that we can quantify or we can distinguish from the other planes that we observe in a three-dimensional setup under different loading condition. So you can have a three-dimensional setup having under uniaxial loading condition or even triaxial loading condition. So under any condition, under any three-dimensional setup, we will be able to identify the special set of planes wherein the shear stress is zero. And once we are able to identify those special set of planes, then based on the angle of inclination that this particular definition of planes, the principal plane gives us, by substituting that angle of inclination, you will be able to calculate the other component of stress, that is normal component of stress experienced by this principal plane. And in this case, it is important to note that the normal component of stress experienced by the principal plane is along the x and y direction individually, and these stresses are equal to the overall stresses that is acting on that three-dimensional plate along these respective direction. So with this, I would like to wind this lecture up, and in the subsequent lecture, we will try to use these understanding and these various ways of describing the components of stress to see how well we can arrive at the different components of stress without this derivation, without these expressions, or without this, all these steps that were involved, trigonometric steps, projection steps, all these that were involved in the derivation, how we can quantify the different components of stress that is acting on a particular region of interest in a three-dimensional material or even in two-dimensional material. So we will begin by considering the two-dimensional material, and from that we will build on the three-dimensional material. So let's see ourselves in the next lecture, wherein we will talk about, or we will largely focus on arriving at similar expression or describing similar components of stress, not through the tedious derivations that we have been seeing so far, at least tedious to me, but through other approaches. We will see if there are other simpler approaches to arrive at the similar expression that we have derived so far. So let's see ourselves in the next lecture. Goodbye.